all cortical consciousness is absolutely contingent, dependent upon brainstem arousal. And brainstem arousal, far from being merely a quantitative dimension of consciousness, you know, wakefulness, the level of consciousness, as Jaak's work showed us, brainstem consciousness, this basic foundational prerequisite for all other forms of consciousness, has a quality, and that quality is affect. The brain is not just an object, it is also a subject. This is the most unique feature of the brain, is that it feels like something to be a brain. And as far as we know, this doesn't apply to anything else in nature.
Welcome to Brain Science, the podcast where we explore how discoveries in neuroscience are helping unravel the mystery of how our brain makes us human. I'm your host, Dr. Ginger Campbell, and this is episode 184. If you're curious about how your brain really works, this is the podcast for you. Last month, we talked with Jeff Hawkins about the cortical origins of intelligence, but this month, we will dive into the deeper parts of the brain to explore the role of subcortical structures and emotions in creating consciousness. I will be talking with Mark Solms about his new book, The Hidden Spring, A Journey to the Source of Consciousness. The excerpt that opened this episode captures two key ideas. Most obvious is the claim that consciousness has a subcortical origin. Longtime listeners will also have noticed Solms' reference to the work of the late Jacques Panksepp. In this interview, Mark shares how Panksepp's work influenced him, as well as his more recent collaboration with Carl Friston, one of the pioneers of computational neuroscience and predictive coding. Before we jump into the interview, I want to remind you that you can find complete show notes and episode transcripts at brainsciencepodcast.com. Brain Science is produced independently, and it relies on the financial support of listeners like you. To learn more, please visit brainsciencepodcast.com/donations. Feel free to send me feedback at brainsciencepodcast@gmail.com, and you can visit our fan page on Facebook. If you'd like to get show notes every month automatically, sign up for our free newsletter. Just text the word brain science, all one word, to 55444. That's brain science, all one word, to 55444. There's also a link in the show notes. I'll be back after the interview to review the key ideas and to tell you how you can help me improve the Brain Science Podcast website. Welcome to Brain Science, Mark Solms. I know that the late Jacques Panksepp thought very highly of your work, so I'm really excited to have you on to talk about your new book, The Hidden Spring, A Journey to the Source of Consciousness.
Thank you.
Mark, would you mind starting out by telling us a little bit about yourself and how you came to be interested in the brain and consciousness?
Oddly enough, it goes all the way back to being 4 years old when my older brother suffered a brain injury. He fell from the roof of a three-story building and had an intracerebral hemorrhage. And that, although he survived the accident and looked the same, he was not the same. And it was terribly, obviously, it was a tragedy for our entire family, but just looked at from my own childish sort of egocentric point of view, it was terribly disturbing that this guy was my brother, but he wasn't the brother that I knew. He was utterly different as a person. And I think that started probably a little earlier than would normally happen. It started a process of, I was going to say intellectual engagement, but it was more a matter of emotional engagement with this curious, disturbing fact that we somehow are our brains, that there's an organ in our mortal bodies which somehow produces our very selves, because damage to that organ, as I had witnessed in my brother's case, changed his very self. It also, I think, confronted me by implication early on with problems of mortality. What if I am my brain and my brain is part of my mortal body, then what happens to me when my brain dies? And these questions, I don't want to understate how strongly they disturbed and worried me as a child. But there wasn't a continuous line from there. But I know somewhere around adolescence, I came to this idea, initially through the realization of mortality, I came to a sort of a nihilistic depression that what's the point of doing anything? Because no matter what you do, you're going to disappear. You just have this brief moment of biological existence and then you're gone forever. And the way I found out of that despair was the idea that the one thing worth doing, the only thing worth doing in the circumstances, is to try to understand what biological being is. What exactly is this thing called subjective existence? There was some remote prospect that if you could objectify subjectivity, if you could transcend the bubble of experience and see something of what it, you know, some bigger picture of how this all works, then maybe in some way we can escape these horribly solipsistic and nihilistic sort of conclusions. So that led me to brain science, and in particular to neuropsychology or behavioral neurology, the mental side of brain function. But when I came into the field, which was in the 1980s, it was very frustrating because you didn't get what you thought you were getting. The mind, as we were taught it, was it all just boiled down to mechanisms, you know, and to functions and to the tools, what Jaak Panksepp would have called the tools of the mind rather than the being of the mind itself. Those questions were not even asked by my professors. Why is there something it is like to have working memory, as opposed to what are the mechanistic rules governing working memory? Why does it have to feel like anything at all? And when I asked them these questions, they kindly and generously warned me, you shouldn't ask questions like that. It's bad for your career. My route into the field is also what frustrated me, because I wasn't really finding in the field the answers to the questions that had driven me there in the first place.
And that sort of reminds me of a similar story that I've heard from Jeff Hawkins, who came along around the same time. And of course, his focus was very different. He wanted to come up with a theory, and nobody and everyone was telling him, no, you can't do a theory. So being told you can't do the thing that's driven you into the field, every medical student feels the same way when you find out that medicine is not like it is on TV either. And then you've got to move on.
Yes and no. I think most of us do move on. You learn, oh, I was naive. I had a childish sort of conception of what this field's all about. And then you get that childish conception beaten out of you and you become part of the compact majority. And I think that takes something of the pleasure and excitement and motivation out of it. And then we become alienated and look for other pleasures. And in my case, this is why I emphasize the emotional aspect of it. It wasn't that I was interested in these questions. It was I needed to answer these questions. It was really a compulsion. I couldn't go along with the fact that I'd made a childish mistake. I wanted to stick with the childish questions. And so I did a very strange thing, which is really not a good career move for a neuroscientist, which is that I decided if I'm interested in the subjective aspect of the mind, and that's not being taught in neuroscience, then let me jump ship and see what the psychoanalysts have to say. And my colleagues were absolutely horrified. In fact, they still are horrified. They say that's like an astronomer studying astrology. But I'm saying that in order to emphasize how frustrated I was with the neuropsychology of the time. Oliver Sacks published at that point in 1984, just before he was so famous, he published a book called A Leg to Stand On.
A great book. And I've read it.
Yeah, it's a great book, a great story, but also cuts to the heart of the issue that we're busy talking about. His great gift was to see things from the patient's point of view, to take seriously the subjective experience of the neurological patient. And he said in that book, there was this one line that really caught my attention. He said, neuropsychology is admirable, but it ignores the psyche. Neuropsychology ignores the psyche. I thought, yes, that's it. That's exactly what I have found. And my journey from then onwards, from the 1980s, was an attempt to bring the psyche into neuropsychology systematically.
Mark, how did you meet Jaak?
It's an interesting story. My first piece of research, my first serious, large piece of research was a study on the brain mechanisms of dreaming. But by the 1980s, of course, we knew all about the brain mechanisms of REM sleep, but that doesn't tell you much about dreams. It was just a correlation. REM sleep and dreams occur together, and REM sleep is governed by brainstem mechanisms. But surely damage to different parts of the cortex is going to affect dreaming differentially. Surely the cortex is doing something in dreams. And so my main focus, as was the norm for neuropsychology, was on the cortical side. The brainstem aspect wasn't really the psychological aspect. And I did this large study, which I won't enumerate all the findings, but one core finding was that damage in the ventromesial frontal white matter leads to a total cessation of dreaming, which was a real surprise, because why should a lesion in the ventral frontal white matter lead to cessation of dreaming? And further studies enabled me to identify that it was the mesocortical, mesolimbic, dopaminergic circuits that were the critical part of that lesion. It then took a very dear colleague, Alan Brown, who had done the best imaging studies on dreaming sleep at around the same time, we're now in the mid-90s, to point out to me that this pathway that I'd identified has its source nucleus in the brainstem, in the ventral tegmental area. So despite my trying to push the story upwards into the cortex in order to include more of the sort of mental side of dreaming in our understanding of its brain mechanisms, ironically, I was driven back down to the brainstem, albeit a different part of the brainstem. The ventral tegmental area is not what drives REM sleep. It's what drives the experience of dreaming. But nevertheless, I was back in the brainstem. And it was the affective, motivational aspects of the mesocortical, mesolimbic dopamine system that interested me, and that led me to YARC, because YARC was and probably remains to this day the greatest expert, absolutely encyclopedic knowledge born of decades of research into the realization that these brainstem mechanisms, far from being external to the mind, are the font of the mind, that these basic raw feelings that YARC studied are really where we need to look to get to the essence of the matter of where sentient subjectivity comes from. So I wrote to YARC and asked him, we had just started a journal which was trying to look at the interface, the interdisciplinary two-way communication possibilities between psychoanalysis and the neurosciences. That journal was called is called Neuropsychoanalysis. So in its inaugural edition issue in 1999, I asked YARC to join in a dialogue with me on how we might update the old psychoanalytical views, which were really in need of updating, by joining them up with what YARC was teaching us about the basic emotional drives that motivate everything that we do. I then also invited him to speak at our inaugural congress of the society that I formed with the same interdisciplinary focus. And so, after corresponding with him and having this dialogue in writing in our first issue of our journal, I then met him and had my first proper in-person dialogues. Remember those things that used to happen when people actually met each other. And that was the beginning of a fantastic scientific collaboration and friendship. YARC was just the most fabulous guy. I miss him terribly.
So basically you met shortly after he published Affective Neuroscience, which was basically a landmark achievement.
Indeed. You mentioned my book. I want to just say that my book is dedicated to YARC's memory. I owe more to him than to any other scientist, alive or dead.
I appreciate that. Mark, would you go ahead and give us like a overview of The Hidden Spring?
Interestingly, it starts exactly where we've started our conversation. It starts with me talking about how I came into the field, what I was looking for, why I was so frustrated, why I took the detour through psychoanalysis, surprising as it seems, how that brought me down from the cortex into the basement of the mind in the brain stem, and then segues into this problem of consciousness by pointing out that we have really missed a trick, and that's putting it perhaps too flippantly because it's a very serious matter, that in our quest to solve the problem of consciousness, the infamous hard problem of consciousness, The model example that we've used is cortical vision. And there's good reason for that. Cortical vision is the best known, best understood aspect of cortical consciousness. It also dominates territorially, takes up more cortical territory than anything else. And so that's been our focus. The problem is twofold, and I'm putting it very simply for now. Firstly, cortical visual processing does not require consciousness, even the highest forms of it. You know, you can recognize a face unconsciously. You can read a word with comprehension unconsciously. You can associate a face with a word unconsciously, and it influences your subsequent attitude to that face, whatever the descriptor was that was associated with it. So if all of this cortical visual processing does not require consciousness, then surely that's not the right place to look. And this is exactly Chalmers's point. David Chalmers's point is, why doesn't all this information processing go on in the dark? What does the experience of seeing? And so he says, trying to understand the functional mechanisms using the ordinary tools of cognitive neuroscience are never going to crack the hard problem. I think the same does not apply when you go down to the brainstem, which is the font of consciousness. It's the all cortical consciousness is absolutely contingent, dependent upon brainstem arousal. And brainstem arousal, far from being merely a quantitative dimension of consciousness, you know, wakefulness, the level of consciousness, as Jaak's work showed us, brainstem consciousness, this basic foundational prerequisite for all other forms of consciousness, has a quality, and that quality is affect. And you can't understand the functional mechanism of affect without understanding why it feels like something, because that's what it's there for. You can't have a feeling without feeling it. That seemed to me to be the right place to look. And so my book then goes into the evidence for that, all the evidence against. I said it was twofold. The one was what I've just said. The other is that if you remove cortex in neonatal mammals, they go on to display perfectly full emotional lives, so much so as that they play and fight and copulate and raise pups to maturity. The idea that consciousness requires cortex, of course, one doesn't know what a rat is experiencing, but children born without cortex also show full emotional responsivity, appropriate emotional responses. And the parents of these children will tell you're crazy if you think they're not conscious. And then there's a whole lot more evidence, which I won't go into now, for example, stimulating these brainstem nuclei stimulates, generates intense affective states. So I go through that evidence, the evidence against cortical consciousness, the evidence for brainstem consciousness being the fundamental form of consciousness, which means affect. And then I unpack, what do we mean by affect? How does it work? And I go into Jaak's findings a lot in that part, sort of middle part of the book. But then I come to the question that Chalmers set for us. Can you bring consciousness into our ordinary causal mechanistic account of nature by specifying its mechanism and what it does? The mechanism of consciousness as raw affect, as in its most elemental form, is something which is reducible to laws. And basically, these are the laws of homeostasis. Then I go into a deeper understanding of how homeostasis causally might generate feeling. And there I bring in Carl Friston's work, all about self-organizing systems, which is a very important part of the story, because self-organizing systems, as the name suggests, have selfhood. They're trying to achieve something for themselves, which is to carry on existing. And then you start getting to these existential questions of what affect's really all about for the system, to the system. So I try to go down to the most basic mechanistic understanding. Can we account for feeling using knowledge drawn from fields which are not about feeling, fields like statistical physics and so on? And then right at the end, after just wrapping up the philosophical loose ends about the hard problem, I end with the question of, if we do really have within our grasp a causal mechanistic understanding of how consciousness is actually generated, then we should be able to reverse engineer it. And crazy as that would have sounded to me just 10 years ago, I find myself now persuaded that, first of all, that if one is going to claim, we do now understand causally how consciousness is generated in a self-organizing system, then we must be able to reverse engineer it. That would be the proof of the pudding. If you're saying this is what causes consciousness, then you should be able to engineer it. So that's where the book ends. Also discussing all of the enormous ethical and metaphysical implications of this stage that I now do believe we've reached. I think we are on the brink of being able to engineer an artificial consciousness, although I hasten to add, an artificial consciousness is just that. It's an artificial consciousness. It's not going to be like yours and mine. And also that we're talking about very simple forms of consciousness. We're talking about raw feelings, things like too hotness or fatigue or diminishing energy supplies, what we experience as hunger, these sorts of very basic primitive affects.
Thanks, Mark. That's a great overview, and I hope it gives listeners a sense of the depth of this book and the fact that we can only hit the high points today. This month, one of our sponsors is Green Chef, the number one meal kit for eating well. Green Chef has certified organic ingredients that come pre-measured, perfectly portioned, and mostly prepped, so you can spend less time stressing and more time enjoying delicious home-cooked meals. Green Chef is easy and affordable, with plans to fit every lifestyle, whether you're into keto, paleo, vegan, vegetarian, or just want to eat healthier. There are recipes for everyone. My favorite thing about Green Chef is the wide variety of recipes and the fact that you can try out meals from the different plans whenever you want. Just go to greenchef.com/90GINGER and use the code 90GINGER to get $90 off, including free shipping. That's greenchef.com/90GINGER, and the promo code is 90GINGER. Give it a try and let me know what you think. Mark, I want to back up now and ask you to talk a little bit, for the sake of people who weren't around back when I talked to Jacques over several years ago, to talk a little bit more about affect and what it is and where it comes from.
Affects are, all of them, homeostatic. So homeostasis, I'm sure all your listeners know about homeostasis, but let me just very briefly remind you that homeostasis is perhaps the defining feature of living organisms as opposed to non-living things. Non-living things are all subject to, absolutely, permanently subject to the second law of thermodynamics, which is that they dissipate. Entropy reigns. And homeostasis resists entropy. We can't dissipate. We can't just be any old temperature, for example. We need to stay within that narrow range that's viable for us. And extending from that comes feeling is how we know how we're doing. If we're moving further away from our viable states, it feels bad. If we're moving closer back towards our viable states, it feels good. So that's the basic mechanism of all affect. But affect doesn't only have a valence, a goodness and badness, which is what I was just alluding to, but also a quality, a categorical quality, so that hunger feels different from thirst, feels different from sleepiness. And this is the starting point of Jacques' work. It is looking at what are the basic categories of affect in the human brain, which turns out to be no different in this respect from the mammalian brain in general. He did meticulous research identifying what these natural kinds of affect are. And you'll notice so far I've only spoken about bodily affects. And Jacques drew a sharp distinction. When I say sharp, of course, there's no sharp distinction in nature. But conceptually, he distinguished between bodily affects, which he divided into interoceptive and extraceptive types. An interoceptive type being the kinds I've spoken about, like hunger and thirst and sleepiness. Extraceptive ones are sensory affects like pain and disgust and fright and so on. And on the one hand, these bodily types, and on the other hand, emotional affects. Emotional affects, too, are homeostatic, in the sense that there is a viable range that we must remain in. For example, in regard to what Jacques calls rage, aggression. The homeostatic settling point there is that there are not frustrating impediments. There aren't agents impeding me from getting what I want. That's where we want to be. If there are such frustrating, irritating, annoying things getting in our way, then we feel just those things I've just said, irritated, frustrated, and annoyed. That's the bad feeling of deviating from that settling point. The same with fear. The settling point is I am not in danger to life and limb. If a predator is coming for me, then it's a homeostatic deviation. So in regard to these basic emotional categories, Jacques identified what the basic emotional needs of the mammal brain are, which is profoundly important knowledge. What are the natural kinds of emotional needs? In other words, what are our viable emotional states? And understanding, identifying the anatomies and chemistries of these circuits gets us to the heart of the matter of the pure science of what are the most basic natural kinds of feeling, which, as I said earlier, is the fundamental form of consciousness, drives everything above it in ways that we might get to discussing. But it also has enormous implications for psychiatry and indeed for psychotherapy, you know, for understanding what, in fact, our whole emotional lives are about. And it also, if I may add, provides an extremely valuable bridge between the psychotherapies and biological psychiatry. Because understanding what these feelings mean, why the patient feels as they do, what they're trying to achieve, what they need to put right in their lives, is exactly the same things that psychopharmacologists are tinkering with chemically. Each one of these systems has its own unique peptidergic and neuromodulatory chemistry. So it lays a foundation for the psychiatry of the future, where we have new opportunities for classifying psychiatric disorders on the basis of the actual natural kinds rather than these artificial categories that are the heritage of our history of our discipline rather than things that actually exist in nature, but also for drug development. And as I say, for undoing this unhappy division between thinking of mental illness psychiatrically versus psychologically. With Jacques' approach, we can do both at the same time.
I know that for years, Antonio Damasio was arguing that the frontal lobes were the source of feeling. And then Bud Craig famously argued that it was the insula, which is a deep cortical structure that's required to be aware of feeling and affect. Why has Damasio changed his position?
I mentioned earlier in this discussion, this journal that we started in 1999, where we tried to bridge the gap between the psychological and neurological approaches to the mind. And when Damasio's early books came out with his cortical understanding of this sort of cortical readout of bodily states, the somatic marker hypothesis, Jacques wrote a review. Jacques was a lovely guy, but he got stuck in when he disagreed with somebody. He didn't beat about the bush. So he wrote a really stinging review of the feeling of what happens. And we gave Antonio a right of reply. And that was the beginning of his engagement with Jacques' understanding of affect as being primarily, fundamentally subcortical. And to his very great credit, and I'm slowing down in order to emphasize this point, to his very great credit, Antonio Damasio changed his mind. You know, there are not many scientists of his reputation that would take such a step, such a climb down. So his next book, Self Comes to Mind, he revised his view entirely. And I have firsthand reason to believe it was entirely due to Jacques' influence. And what is more, in Self Comes to Mind, Damasio acknowledges Jacques' priority in this respect. The transition from a corticocentric theory of affect and indeed selfhood, Damasio moved down to the brainstem along precisely the path that Jacques blazed for us, a trail that he blazed for us.
So how does this issue relate to our understanding of consciousness?
Well, one of the problems is what we mean by that word. So many cognitive scientists seem to take human consciousness as their starting point. Definitional of what we mean by consciousness is what you and I are busy experiencing right now. But that isn't the normal scientific approach. Why do you start with the most complex, highly evolved version of something? In science, you want to reduce things down to their elements, to their basic sort of working parts. And so you would want to go to the source of consciousness, to its origins, both physiologically speaking, in terms of the hierarchy of how the brain is constructed, but also in evolutionary terms, to the dawn of consciousness. How did it all, what's it for? You know, why did it evolve at all? So I think that's part of the problem, is that when cognitive scientists speak about consciousness, the raw feelings are not even on their radar. When you do bring them onto their radar, then they think about feelings in terms of, as a bit of a pun in what I'm saying, they think about feelings in terms of thinking about feelings. In other words, you know, when you reflect upon your emotional states, that's not raw feeling. It's not raw affect. When you point out, you show them all the evidence for the view, Yark's view, that raw feelings are generated in and of themselves in the brainstem. They don't need cortex to be read out, and you don't need to think about your feelings. Then they start disagreeing with the view that these are actually felt. And they start saying these are reflexes, these are instinctual behaviors. How do we know that you really feel? And at that point, I'm afraid it becomes ideological, because the evidence now is so overwhelming. In science, you look for converging lines of evidence using different methods. And this is what we've done. So I said earlier, children without cortex appear to be conscious. But how do you know? Well, you don't, but they appear to be conscious. They can't speak, so they can't tell you. Adults with no insula, which is what Bud Craig says, the insula is where the self is that brings together all of these sort of basic bodily afferents. Patients with no insula at all, they talk to you about their selfhood. Are they lying? It's incoherent to speak about somebody without a self pretending to have a self. Likewise, I report in my book one extraordinary case that I had, a man with absolutely no prefrontal cortex due to pathology. It was he wasn't born like that. And I interview him about his selfhood. And the evidence is abundantly clear that there's somebody at home. And what is more, both the patient without insula, which was one of Antonio's patients, and my patient without prefrontal lobes, which is the other. The global workspace theorists all speak about the prefrontal lobes being where this global workspace is, which is where consciousness is construed by them in this cognitive cortical way. And not only is my patient able to talk about his mental experiences and recognize that they're his, that in other words, there's a self there, but also he's full of feeling. And this we've always known, that frontal lobe patients are in fact overwhelmed with a superabundance of feeling. So if feeling, as Joe Ledoux claims, is in fact only felt, these unconscious subcortical processes as they construe them are only felt when they're registered in the prefrontal cortex. If that were true, then why does my patient with no prefrontal cortex have such strong emotional states, as we know from frontal cases generally? If there's an absence of frontal cortex, there should be less feeling, if that's what feeling is, just the cortical readout of those subcortical processes, and so on and so on. I could carry on. I mentioned earlier deep brain stimulation. You stimulate reticular activating nuclei and you generate intense affects. You stimulate periaqueductal gray. You generate intense affects. The converging lines of evidence all point to the conclusion that these subcortical processes are conscious in and of themselves. Sadly, Antonio Damasio is the exception, that he managed to see that the evidence for what it was and climbed down off this cortical fallacy and changed his mind. I think it might take a generation for others to catch up with that. But I think the evidence, I'm sorry if I'm repeating myself, the evidence simply is overwhelming, that raw affects are generated subcortically. They don't need cortex at all.
And would you talk a little bit about the evidence that consciousness itself arises subcortically?
The strongest piece of evidence for that is the finding of Fisher and colleagues in 2015, where they looked at a large number of human coma cases and were able to specify that all that's required, they call it a coma-specific region, all that's required for coma in human beings is a 2 cubic millimeter. I know you guys in the States don't use this unit of measurement, but basically an area the size of a match head. That's the area of damage that's required in the parabrachial region of the brainstem, that is to say, in the reticular activating brainstem. You only need that much damage to obliterate all consciousness in a human being. So the strongest line of evidence that the fundamental source of consciousness is the upper brainstem is that. And then you add to that the sort of evidence I've just been talking about, like I said about the deep brain stimulation of these nuclei and observing the responses you get are intense affects felt by these patients. Then there you have it, that consciousness in itself comes from the brainstem, because if you make a tiny little lesion there, it's gone. And remember, if you remove cortex entirely, it's not gone. Then add to that the fact that consciousness has a quality, which is affect. And I think there, that's all you need in order to demonstrate the point.
So how is this different from the view of the reticular activating system that first year medical students are taught, which I guess is just like an off-on switch?
Exactly. That is the, sadly, not only first year medical students. This is what cognitive neuroscientists believe across the board. It's still a very small number of us growing, but it's a small number of us who have any influence on the field, who point to the wrongheadedness of what those first-year students are taught. What they're taught is, as you just put it, that it's an on-off switch. I like the analogy of a television set and its power supply. You can't have television unless it's plugged into the wall and switched on. But that doesn't mean that television actually comes from the power supply in the wall. This is the analogy that they are taught. This view is what's inculcated in those students, that what the reticular activating system supplies is power, this kind of energy source or purely quantitative dimension, the volume control, if you will, if not an on-off switch. And that the televisual stuff, the real content of television, happens inside the television set itself. In other words, the cortex. Now, if that were true, then if you damage the power supply to a television set, what you get is the screen dims at least, or goes blank. In other words, you get the equivalent of coma. But when you damage these structures in human, well, I should really say stimulate, because this is where you're able to causally manipulate what they do, then it changes the content of what the patient is experiencing. There's a study of a 65-year-old woman who'd never had any psychiatric history. She had Parkinson's disease, and he put a deep brain stimulator into, just aiming for the subthalamic nucleus, but hitting the substantia nigra accidentally, not realizing he was actually in substantia nigra, in other words, part of the reticular activating system. When he stimulated that nucleus, within 5 seconds, she fell into a suicidal depression, the most intense depressive state. And then when he switched the electrode off, she came out of it within 30 seconds, and he was reliably able to switch depression on and off by fiddling with this part of her reticular activating system. So that clearly isn't just a power supply. It's changing the program of the television set. It's changing its content. And so that view, which started in 1949 with Maruzzi and Magoon already, that what the brainstem supplies is just this background level of wakefulness, that view is truly unsustainable in light of evidence of the kind that I've just spoken of. Consciousness in itself comes from the brainstem, because if you make a tiny little lesion there, it's gone. And remember, if you remove cortex entirely, it's not gone. Then add to that the fact that consciousness has a quality, which is affect.
I want to take a few moments to tell you about one of my favorite apps, Text Expander, which is available for Mac, Windows, Chrome, iPhone, and iPad. If you work with a team, Text Expander will help you keep your team consistent, accurate, and current. Snippets can include everything from text to images so that everyone uses the same language. This makes Text Expander a great tool for customer support, and it allows you to work faster and smarter. To get 20% off your first year, just go to textexpander.com/podcast to learn more. Visit textexpander.com/podcast for 20% off your first year. And don't forget to tell them that you heard about it on Brain Science.
consciousness in itself comes from the brainstem, because if you make a tiny little lesion there, it's gone. And remember, if you remove cortex entirely, it's not gone. Then add to that the fact that consciousness has a quality, which is affect. What it says is that if we accept, as we must, that this is the foundation of consciousness, it's prerequisite, the reticular activating system. That's what all the medical students are taught, that first you have to have wakefulness, then you can have what the cortex adds. If we accept that, which we must, and we accept that those brainstem nuclei generate affects, then we are led to the view, which is, I think, profoundly important, that the foundations of all of our complicated human consciousness, the foundations of it, the bedrock of it, is feeling. And that has massive implications for our whole way of understanding, not only consciousness, but mental life altogether.
So does that give you a slightly different definition of consciousness?
Well, it's, as I said a few minutes ago, when you spoke about the disagreements between the cortical and brainstem views of consciousness, it does depend on what you mean by consciousness, because nobody would claim that all of our complex reflexive self-awareness is generated in the reticular activating system. Far from it. All that's generated there is raw feelings. But it makes a huge difference to understand that all of consciousness, including our higher cortical cognitions, is dependent upon affective arousal. That means that we need to rethink what these higher cortical forms of conscious cognition are all about. And my view, and I think in this respect, I'm no different from Jaak, my view is that these higher cortical forms of consciousness are merely elaborations of affect. In other words, they are, if I can put it in a pithy sort of formulation, I feel like this. That's the brainstem's contribution. The organism feels something. And then secondly, it's, I feel like this about that. And so the affect is extended onto its context, which is very important. The context of what we feel explains what it is that's making us feel this way. And it is there in the outside world that we can do something about it. In other words, this bad feeling, air hunger, suffocation alarm, this bad feeling, how do I get rid of it? Well, I have to move around in the outside world. I'm in a building that's burning. It's filling up with carbon dioxide. Where should I go? And the feeling of increasing or decreasing respiratory distress, it tells the person, you're going the right way or you're going the wrong way. We're speaking here of an emergency situation, of course, but please notice the interrelationship between the affects and the cognitions. The thought, where should I go? Is this the right way? Do I go left? Do I go right? Do I go up? Do I go down? Is guided by feeling. So the way I like to think about it is that the feeling is a demand made upon the mind for work. You require work in order to get rid of this, to correct this homeostatic error. And then the cognition, the conscious cognition, is the work itself. Of course, it is not the same thing as affect. It is the response to the affect. It's what am I going to do about this affect? That's what cognitive scientists are theorizing about. They're theorizing about that part of our consciousness, which I agree is not just the affect, but that's not the way they normally theorize about it. It really casts a very important new light on consciousness in cognition to recognize that it's there. The reason why we have it at all is because it enables us to meet our needs in the outside world. It's driven by affect, and it contextualizes affect. And I want to emphasize one particular point, which was implicit in what I just said, is that person who's trying to escape the carbon dioxide-filled part of the burning building and trying to find escape, the feeling that tells them where the oxygen is, the crucial bit is that it enables them to make choices. If I go this way, it feels bad. If I go that way, it feels good. So I choose to go where it feels good. And this is what consciousness in cognition is for. Conscious cognition is for voluntary action as opposed to reflex action. And I think that nexus is pivotal, that feeling enables choice. A feeling is not the same thing as the choice. So I say again, I recognize that conscious cognition is something other than feeling. It's felt cognition. But the issue, the fundamental issue there is that the solving, the working memory, I like that, is the work. The solving of the problem must be guided by a value system. Otherwise, how do you make a choice? There must be a right way and a wrong way, a good way and a bad way. And so the affects are the grounding value system, but raised to the level of cognition. It is my predicted, my course of action. I predict if I go this way, things will work out well for me. And if I go that way, they won't. Those predictions, if your prediction is turning out as expected, that's good cognitively. If uncertainty is prevailing, in other words, things are not going as expected, that's bad cognitively. And I think that's a crucial principle for understanding the cognitive forms of consciousness. It's all about managing uncertainty. And again, you can see how that higher statistical concept of uncertainty in a data distribution, how that, in the terms that I've just described it to you, can ultimately be grounded in these raw affective feelings of goodness and badness.
Right. So I'm going to ask you kind of a devil's advocate question here. If feelings, as you argue in your book, are the most fundamental aspect of consciousness, given that even a bacteria can move toward nutrients and away from noxious stimuli, how do we determine where consciousness actually begins? Because I wouldn't think that a bacteria is conscious.
Yes, I agree with you. So as we all know in science, you know, we want to reduce things down to their most basic forms, and then we slowly build it up. What a single cell organism does have is some primitive form of selfhood. That doesn't mean it's sentient selfhood. It means it is, there's a boundary, a membranous boundary, the internal states, the external states, and those internal states are trying to achieve something, that is to say, trying to maintain the viability of the cell as a system, which means it has to react to its surrounds. In other words, it has sensory states, and it has to do things in response to the sensory states which are not viable for it. So it's an intentional creature. It has selfhood, it has aim and purpose, which is to carry on existing. But what I've just described to you can all be done on an entirely mechanistic basis. There can be pre-set algorithms, and indeed there are.
There's no choice.
There's no choice. This is a crucial part of it. Now, another crucial part of it is that as we have more needs, so what you've just said about choice, that has to do with uncertainty. In other words, if you're in an environment for which your algorithms, your preset reflexes, they can't tell the creature what to do in this environment because it's a novel environment. It's an environment where unexpected parameters, unknown parameters carry the day. Then this additional capacity for choice, in other words, for feeling, not having a prediction, but for making here and now choices on the basis of here and now developments. So that's what feeling adds. And it's not only that it adds the capacity to navigate unpredicted environments, which is an enormous and adaptive advantage, but also it becomes almost essential. In fact, I would say it becomes essential to have quality attaching to valence. Let me just be clear here. I don't want to get too abstruse, but it's a purely quantitative thing. How far has the organism deviated from its set point? That you can measure that. There's no need to feel it, even though I'm saying that's the basis of feeling. It only needs to be felt when you introduce categorical variables, that is to say, multiple needs. So if the organism has multiple needs, and the more complex the organism becomes, the more complex its interior, the more needs it has, then you need to treat each of these needs categorically. That is to say, if you have 5 out of 10 of hunger and 1 out of 10 of thirst and 3 out of 10 of sleepiness and 2 out of 10 of pain, et cetera, that's not one total common denominator of, you know, 45 out of 100 of total need. So all you need to do is minimize the total number. You can't do that. You have to meet each one of those needs because your nutritional needs must be met. Your hydration needs must be met. Your rest, your need to rest must be met. Your need to defecate must be met. You can't just average them. So you need to treat them as categorical variables, which means they need to be qualitatively distinct from each other. Now you add those two things to the mix, that on the one hand, you need to have multiple different needs, which are color-coded, categorical variables, and you need to be able to, in an uncertain environment, you don't have fixed algorithms. You need to prioritize one need over another, depending upon the context. Those two things combined give you the basic functional features of an affect, which is that it has both valence and quality. And so a single-celled organism doesn't have those design features that I've just spoken of.
It just has valence.
It just has valence. And it has preordained predictions. What I've just described to you, not only does it have the features that I've said, in other words, the capacity for choice, therefore adaptation to an unpredicted and unknown and novel environment, but then also learning from experience. So on the base, and there we go back to bad old behaviorism, the law of effect. Those things which are rewarding are done again. Those things that are punishing are avoided in future. This is the basic mechanism of learning. Jacques naughtily calls it the law of affect because, of course, rewards and punishments are simply feelings. And so there we also have the capacity to not only to make choices here and now, but also to learn from experience and update our predictive models of how to meet our needs in the world.
Mark, this has been a very fascinating conversation. And before we close, I want to talk a little bit about your work with Carl Friston, and perhaps you could start by just telling us a little bit about the paper that triggered your collaboration.
Yes, I had met Carl. We'd had a few conversations between 2010 and 2017, and I read the paper that you're referring to in 2013. It's called Life as We Know It. It's in one of the journals of the Royal Society. I didn't properly understand the paper, I must confess to you, because it's Carl Friston. He's basically a physicist as much as he is a neuroscientist. I just couldn't properly get my head around all those equations. But in 2017, I was going to be his discussant at a conference. And so in order not to embarrass myself, I had to now master the physics in that paper. And thank God I did, because upon rereading it and properly understanding it for the first time, what he achieves in that paper is putting it in its simplest terms. You remember the title, Life as We Know It. And remember what I said earlier about homeostasis being what keeps us alive, what distinguishes us from non-living things is that we don't just dissipate. We work to maintain ourselves in particular ranges. And that paper of Carl Friston's reduced that mechanism to lawful equations. He identified what the laws are that govern homeostasis in complex dynamical systems like biological systems. There, I suddenly realized if consciousness is an extended form of homeostasis, in other words, if feeling is an extended form of homeostasis, which, as I've said repeatedly now, I think the evidence is very strong that that's what it is, then I thought Carl Friston's equations, which explain the lawful behavior of homeostasis, can be extended to providing likewise causal account of the fundamental mechanisms of affect and therefore of the most basic form of consciousness. So we began a collaboration which culminated in a paper the next year, 2018. It was published in the Journal of Consciousness Studies. That's because that's where David Chalmers's original paper where he set the hard problem of consciousness was published. In his famous paper, he asks the question, he says something like, we all know that consciousness somehow arises in physical systems, but we have no idea how and why it so arises. Our paper had the title, How and Why Consciousness Arises. And it's an attempt to explicate these basic lawful mechanisms that underpin the most elementary form of consciousness. But now Friston, prior to our collaboration, had been doing brilliant work on cortical forms of cognition, using basically Bayesian statistics in conjunction with the free energy principle. He had reduced to statistical physics the sort of basic working mechanisms of our higher cortical mantle. What excited me most after our paper in 2018 was then trying to integrate these two. Friston's earlier work on the statistical physics of cognition with the work we had done together on the similar mechanisms of elemental consciousness. And that's what I try in the most difficult chapters in my book. I must just tell you, if any of your listeners are going to buy the book, the hard chapters are the ones where I try to do that, try to sketch a bigger picture model of not just how raw affects are generated, but how they interdigitate with cognitions within this Fristonian framework, the free energy principle. Those are chapters 7 and 9. So please slow down on chapter 7 and 9. It's worth it. Don't stop there, because the vistas that open up after that in chapters 10, 11, and 12 are certainly worth the effort.
I agree completely, because like I said, as we were talking before we started recording, I interviewed Evan Thompson years ago, and I see this as the next step. I mean, it really fills in the missing piece for solving the hard problem. And I think maybe we might just have to leave that as a teaser because of the, you know, unless you want to say something about it.
No, I'll tell you what I do want to say, Ginger, which might be a good way to bring us back to where we started. I have a deep sense of, what can I call it, contentedness, that the thing that so disturbed and distressed me as a little kid and that drove me into the field in the first place, and that, as I said to you, and as we both know, it was so hard to sustain asking these basic childish questions as you become a proper scientist, that I just have such a sense of relief and tranquility that I really feel, at least to my satisfaction, we've got the basic shape of a solution within our grasp. I don't believe that I have wrapped up every last detail of the problem, but I really think that the hard problem is fundamentally soluble now. And that brings me back to where my whole quest started. And so it's very gratifying.
Mark, what else would you like to share before we close?
I think that we, you know, science is a process of ongoing progress, of course. And so as excited as I am about the point that we've reached now, I'm very much aware that this will in due course be looked back upon as slightly misguided, that they got this part wrong and so on. But what I would like to see as a kind of lasting contribution of my own to our science, so much bigger than me and our generation, extending into the future, is just this, that we remember and recognize and acknowledge and build into our whole approach that the brain is not just an object, it is also a subject. This is the most unique feature of the brain, is that it feels like something to be a brain. And as far as we know, this doesn't apply to anything else in nature. And this can't be an accidental, trivial detail about how the brain works. I think that if we don't come to grips with how and why it feels like something to be a brain, why the brain, unlike any other organ of the body or anything else in nature, as far as we understand it, why it has sentient subjectivity, I think that we will never understand how the brain works if we don't have that aspect of the brain at the center of our formulations. So if the neuroscience of the future or of the next generation or two can incorporate properly, seriously, the problem of subjectivity into our field, and then I think people like me and Jaak and Antonio and people who were never taken seriously by proper neuroscientists like good old Oliver Sacks. Somebody nastily said of Oliver, he was the man who mistook his patience for a literary career. But he really deserves credit too for having brought subjectivity into our field. And if those people that I've mentioned, if that can be our legacy, then I think we will have achieved enough to have made it worthwhile.
Mark, the one question I try to ask all my guests is, what is your advice for students?
Based on my own experience and what we've been discussing today, don't forget what exciting mysteries and curiosity and interest brought you into the field in the first place. It's a tragedy to see these questions in a sort of like panel beated out of students. Don't lose sight of your dreams. That would be my advice. I think that if we can have a neuroscience of the future, which takes seriously the sentient subject of the brain, the being of the brain, I mean, what could be more interesting than that? I say that to my students. I say to them that I don't understand why anybody studies anything else. I mean, what could possibly be more interesting, you know, than this? It's precisely the subjective aspect of it, the psychological aspect of brain science, that is what sets it apart from all of the rest of biology and medicine. My advice to students who are interested in the brain because they think of it as the organ of the mind, the organ of their very being, their very sentient existence, they mustn't lose sight of that is indeed what is interesting and important about the brain, and not get distracted by all of the technology. And as important as it is, all of the objective methods that we have are not really being properly utilized if they're not being utilized ultimately in the service of understanding this unique feature of the brain. That's my advice to them.
That's an excellent closing idea. And of all the guests that have come on this show, I think one of the things that they have and you all have in common is that you've held on to that that emotion, that thing that really drives us, which is that question that we need to know the answer to. Needing to know the answer, that's an affect, right?
Indeed. It's to cut down to essentials, that mesocortical mesolimbic dopamine system I spoke about, which turned out to be the brain circuit that more than any other drives the dream process, is what Jacques called the seeking system. And that word captures it. What are we doing? We're seeking. That's what science is all about. We want to reduce uncertainty by being excited by novelty. That is to say, we are positively engaging with uncertainty. That's what seeking is. That's what epistemophilia is, the love of knowledge. And this is what drives us all. And at its bare bones, Jacques identified this brain mechanism for it. And certainly it drove him, that's for sure.
Yeah, because he kept on working when he was near death. So you can't be much more driven than that.
I said at a memorial service for Jacques that we have to be honest. After his second chemo, he had three bouts of very heavy treatment for his cancer. After the second one, as he himself freely admitted, he had what they call chemo brain. He lost some of his edge, cognitive edge. But as I said at this memorial service that I was mentioning, I said, let's not forget, Jacques never rated the cortex that highly anyway.
Yeah, that's one thing I want to say before we close that really came home to me as I was reading your book, because I have talked so much over the last few years on my show about how most of what the brain does is unconscious. And we're really talking about the cortex. I mean, it's really kind of flips everything over. The cortex is doing most of its work unconsciously, but getting all the credit or trying to take it.
Exactly. It does, as you say, flip our old ideas upside down. Who would have thought it? But that's where progress comes from, being willing to abandon old ideas and engage with the new.
And von Helmholtz was one of the first to figure that out, that a lot of stuff was going on unconscious. So sometimes you just discover stuff before people are ready.
Carl Friston, who's probably, if you go by H-indexes, he's the most influential neuroscientist in the world today. And Carl Friston gives credit more than to anyone else. He gives credit for his own insights to the very man you just mentioned, Helmholtz.
Well, thanks so much for taking the time to talk with me today, Mark.
Thank you, Ginger. Thank you for your interest. It's been a really enjoyable discussion. Thank you.
I want to thank Mark Solms for taking the time to talk with me about his new book, The Hidden Spring, A Journey to the Source of Consciousness. I think this book will be of particular interest to listeners who resonate with the work of the late Jacques Panksepp. One of the goals of this book was to counteract what Solms calls the cortical fallacy, which is the long-running assumption that the cortex is the source of consciousness. We reviewed some of the evidence that consciousness actually has subcortical origins. This evidence goes beyond Jacques Panksepp's pioneering work and includes the fact that children without a cortex are clearly conscious. Another piece of evidence is that consciousness is wiped out by damage to a critical area of the reticular activating system, which is a brainstem structure. Your first response to this claim might be, well, why does it matter? The answer is that this has many critical implications for our understanding of consciousness. Most obvious is the implication that non-human animals may be conscious. Besides Jacques Panksepp, another guest who pointed this out was John Mallet, co-author of The Ancient Origins of Consciousness, which we discussed back in episode 128, where Mallet introduced us to the intriguing possibility that even insects might be conscious. I will have a link to that episode in the show notes at brainsciencepodcast.com. So what is the role of the cortex? Obviously, the cortex is critical to normal human consciousness, even if it isn't the only component. But ironically, a lot of what the cortex does is actually unconscious. This is a theme we've talked about often. For example, an estimated 40% of the cortex is devoted to vision, but most of this processing is actually automatic, or as Solms said, it relies on mechanistic algorithms that don't involve choice. He pointed out that, in contrast, novel environments contain more uncertainty, which introduces a role for choice. The subcortical circuits are the origin of both valence and categories. For example, hunger and thirst both feel bad, but they aren't the same. He pointed out that we can't have fixed priorities because the situation will determine which affect should drive our behavior. And as he said, learning from behavior actually requires affect. We learn to do what's rewarding. We touched very briefly on his collaboration with Carl Friston, who is an extremely influential computational neuroscientist who has developed a free energy theory that demonstrates a natural relationship between self-organizing systems and homeostasis. I don't feel I can do justice to Friston's elegant work, but I will mention that it will appeal to those of you who are fans of Terence Deacon. I'm going to include links to the key papers in the show notes and encourage anyone who wants to learn more to read The Hidden Spring. I have to emphasize that this interview just scratches the surface. Mark Solms is very passionate about the importance of the subcortical origins of consciousness, which is to say, the most primitive aspects of affect or subjective experience. However, I want to caution against either-or thinking. Acknowledging these subcortical elements does not negate the importance of the cognitive contributions that are unique to the human cortex. However, I think it's valuable to remember a few key principles that go against many long-standing assumptions about the brain and consciousness. First, we've learned that consciousness can be knocked out completely by damaging a very small area of the brainstem, and this is not because it's like an on-off switch. These subcortical circuits are sending critical information to the cortex that's the very essence of subjective experience. You might even say this is the solution to the so-called hard problem of subjective experience, because this is where a subjective experience appears to originate. The other surprising discovery, which has been confirmed by many researchers, is that much of the complex processing done in the cortex is totally automatic. It's beyond both our conscious access and control. Sure, when we learn something new, it may be conscious, but once a skill is well learned, it becomes unconscious. I find myself wondering whether the terms conscious and unconscious are adequate to describe what is actually an amazingly integrated process. I would love to hear your feedback about this episode. You can write to me at brainsciencepodcast@gmail.com. Also, please visit brainsciencepodcast.com to get complete show notes and episode transcripts. If you'd like to get episode show notes automatically every month, please sign up for the free Brain Science newsletter at our website, brainsciencepodcast.com, or text Brain Science, all one word, to 55444. That's Brain Science, all one word, to 55444. Also, I hope you'll check out my book, Are You Sure? The Unconscious Origins of Certainty. It's available at all e-sellers like Amazon. And if you'd like an autographed copy, just email me at brainsciencepodcast@gmail.com. Brain Science relies on the support of listeners like you. To learn more, please visit brainsciencepodcast.com/donations. Last month, I started asking for volunteers to help with redesigning the Brain Science Podcast website. It's gotten kind of crufty because of having nearly 15 years of content. So please reach out to me at brainsciencepodcast@gmail.com if you're interested in helping. Even if all you want to do is to send me a list of what you think works and what doesn't work on the current website. Next month, I'll be back with a new interview. My guest will be Stephen Fleming, author of Know Thyself, The Science of Self-Awareness. Until then, I hope you'll check out my other podcasts, Books and Ideas and Graying Rainbows. Thanks again for listening. I look forward to talking with you again very soon. Brain Science is copyright 2021 to Virginia Campbell, MD. You may copy it to share it with others, but for any other uses or derivatives, please contact me at brainsciencepodcast@gmail.com. The theme music for Brain Science is Mindfire, written and performed by Tony Catracia. You can find his work at syncopationnow.com.